Well, yeah, as you know, we've worked on over the past several years at NPH on countywide and city measures to bring forward funding for affordable housing with a two-thirds requirement. Fortunately, we have a very progressive electorate with the political will to be able to do that and tax themselves and invest in affordable housing for others, which is tremendous. But for those jurisdictions that don't necessarily have that electorate or the political will to get that two-thirds, which is a very high bar, it doesn't really help lower-income people who happen to be in those communities to get those resources that they need as well. And as it was mentioned earlier, obviously, in a very wealthy area, we want to make sure that we have equity in terms of both the resources that we're providing at the local level in addition to what we may are able to get at the state level, because it's really important to have that first money in at the local level and to be able to leverage funds to be competitive to bring more affordable housing resources into a community. And so the first issue is a lower voter approval threshold, which is one approach to that. As you know, this requires a constitutional amendment. It's a very heavy lift. And over the past few years, we have seen constitutional amendments both on the assembly side and the state senate introduced. But we really think it would be important to have our region on record saying, yes, we support this lower voter threshold because it's a move toward greater democracy and not one-third veto over the ability of residents to invest in their own communities. Just to remind you, Proposition 39 from 2000 allowed school districts for school facilities bonds to use the 55% threshold. The enhanced infrastructure financing districts have a 55% threshold. And for example, the bridge tolls, which are considered a user fee idea, you're doing obviously maintenance on bridges, but also other investments to reduce traffic congestion, which is a direct benefit to the person paying that toll. That's just a simple majority, for example, like the RM3. And yet we have a two-thirds threshold for some of these other measures. And so we think it makes sense to bring this forward and at least for, as a region, let our legislators know that we support this to try to get this moving. Just to remind you, there were a couple, at least, constitutional amendments in this session that have been introduced. ACA 4, Assembly Constitutional Amendment 4, by Assemblymember Aguiar Curry, who also chairs the Assembly Committee on Local Government, would have lowered that threshold for infrastructure investments and affordable housing, and we were on record supporting that, but we really appreciate having our CASA and MTC and ABAG on record in support as well going forward to really inspire our legislators who are willing to bring these constitutional amendments forward. And then Senator Scott Wiener had Senate Constitutional Amendment 6, and that would only reduce that voter threshold for transportation measures, and we think housing needs to be included in that as well. And it would send a message, I think, for CASA to say, yes, we're going to go ahead and support this type of a constitutional amendment, but housing must also be able to benefit from that lower voter threshold. These require two-thirds votes of the legislature, and they go directly onto the ballot if you're able to get that. And then, of course, you'd have to run the campaign, as was done again for under Prop 39 for schools in 2000, and we would do that for a broad range of infrastructure investments, including affordable housing and transportation. So we'd like to, that's one of our asks today. Let's go ahead and transition to redevelopment agencies. As you know, RDA 2.0 has been a work in progress over several sessions now. And Assemblymember David Chu brought forward AB 3037 in this session. It was held in Assembly Appropriations. But we'd like to be engaged in those conversations, really be able to bring a regional voice and support to Assemblymember Chu and his co-authors, and really have some input in the way that that tool comes together in terms of tax increment finance, and also point out Lieutenant Governor Gavin Newsom has talked frequently about the need for tax increment financing as part of the solution, in addition to $500 million per year in additional state affordable housing tax credits. And we'd like to be part of those conversations. The initial bill idea would be have a 30% set aside for low and moderate income housing. We'd like to see that higher. It also has a large menu of various types of infrastructure projects, including bridges and freeways, et cetera, which we think may be a little bit too expansive for this particular purpose, given the potential revenues that may be generated and how we'd like to focus those revenues. So we'd like to be able to have those kinds of discussions with the author, but having the backing and support of CASA to be able to do that and to bring a collective voice into those conversations. We have talked about a 50% low mod set aside for affordable housing, or even more deeply income target, and just a low and very low, for example, including homelessness housing as a potential to direct those revenues. The idea here would be to set aside $1 billion from the state's general fund to backfill schools, so that you're able to get a larger portion of that property tax at the local level without any impact to education. And as you know, that takes up almost half of the 50 cents on the dollar for every tax increment dollar. So the school funding, so it would be a significant boost to what you can currently get with tax increment financing, where you can't touch the school portion of property taxes. But so we think it's really important for our region. As you saw in the surveys, our decision makers also say the loss of redevelopment was devastating, and they need to replace those revenues with some kind of tax increment tool is very important, and one that has significant juice, as it were, and can bring funding. Other issues about it, though, is obviously significant general fund impact at the state level, so we'll need to engage with the new governor around that. Also, lots more oversight, and to avoid abuses, which we had seen previously with previous iterations of redevelopment. So lots of oversight, approval needed from the Strategic Growth Council to demonstrate that this is not going to be sprawl-inducing types of investments in infrastructure, but really will be infill and help us to meet our climate change goals as well, and align with the other policies that the state has adopted to get the infill and transit-oriented housing built. So oversight, sign-off from Strategic Growth Council, also sign-off from the Department of Finance. To make sure that you've got a housing plan that you can really deliver on, and then yearly audits as well that the state controller would have oversight of. So lots of involvement by the state, which the cities may or may not like, but to try to avoid some of those abuses and make sure that if the state is going to backfill the schools portion, that they're getting value for the dollars that they're willing to invest in this tool. So once again, we do expect Assemblymember Chu to come back next session with this and engage the new governor immediately on that. And then finally, wanted to just bring to your attention the tax increment tool that we've been working on that is much more narrowly focused on affordable housing. It's called the Affordable Housing Authorities, not to be confused with public housing authorities, but this is a tool that's easy for jurisdictions to stand up with very little intervention from the state, as it were, but for the city to tap into the county portion of tax increment, there would need to be an MOU and an agreement to be able to do that on projects of mutual interest and benefit. But you can also issue bonds, and that part of the idea is to be able to issue bonds without voter approval, because it's you're not increasing taxes, it's an existing tax base. And the idea really came out of things in particular, for example, like we're seeing on the peninsula, where you have lots of new office and commercial projects being approved, and it's not really an issue of trying to identify blight and addressing blight, but really just to try to capture some of that new assessed value, where in some of our jurisdictions assessed value has been increasing 10% or more year over year, and to be able to capture at least a portion of that, invest that back into affordable housing to address the jobs housing gap. And so that's what this tool would be able to do. A city could do that and issue debt for 45 years. And then invested in an affordable housing plan, very quickly set up, relatively little intervention from the state, and to be able to meet their housing needs at the local level and kind of craft a plan that meets their needs without having to go to the voters for approval for new taxes. And that was AB 1598 that was signed into law last year. We've actually got some cleanup legislation this year based on input from local jurisdictions who are studying the tool, as well as bond council, who's talked about what they need to do to be able to sell these bonds potentially to generate revenues for affordable housing. So we've got that bill going through the legislature. We're also pleased to note that Assemblymember Jim Frazier's got a bill that would also allow affordable housing related infrastructure to also be financed with this tool. That's not direct, just not a direct off-site improvement, but larger improvements in the general area that would serve the affordable housing to be built, AB 1792. And so this is all coming together very well. And we do think if there is a backfill from the state, this tool could also potentially benefit from that. We wouldn't want it to have that the ability to do that as well. But the idea here would be you could also do an MOU between among cities and county at the local level. And have it even set up a JPA where you could pool resources, and then if you have a housing pipeline going forward, then those resources could be nimble and could be moved around as needed to move that pipeline at the county level with participating cities. And they don't have to take the full increment, it can just be a portion of the increment, and they can either bond against that or not, but it can also be sales taxes as well as property taxes, local sales taxes, that could be added to that revenue stream to be able to finance affordable housing. So this is the kind of the flexible tool that we wanted to set up. Earlier this year, we were able to make a presentation to a joint hearing of the Assembly Housing Community Development Committee and Local Government Committee about these tools. The League of California Cities has actually been in support of this tool. We've been working with them on this as well. I think it's the most powerful tax increment financing tool to date, and they've also been very supportive of the additional cleanup and are sharing these potential tools with their member cities. And we hope to see once these cleanup bills are signed into law to be able to see to move into the implementation phase and see some jurisdictions be able to stand this up. There's no geographic limitations on it. It could be the entire jurisdiction of the city and just take a portion of it across the top, or you could take all the tax increment from just a relatively small part of the city where you do expect to have significant commercial and office development and try to tap into some of the additional assessed value that you'll realize from that development as it comes online. So we tried to really create a flexible tool for people to use. And one of the things that we could do is actually look at this as a tool in the region without new taxes to be able to get some agreements at the county level and or at the regional level to stand up a tax increment tool like this. Be glad to take any questions or comments.